Hello everyone, and welcome to this talk that will be about virtual topology for virtual machines. Someone once said, in theory there is no difference between theory and practice, but in practice there is. I personally like this sentence a lot, and I think that it applies quite well to virtualization, particularly so to the topic at hand, which is whether providing a virtual machine with a virtual topology is good, bad, or something in between. Anyway, in some more details, this talk will be about this function in the Linux kernel scheduler code called try2wakeup. It will be about this graph, and it will be about these log entries reporting an unmitigated vulnerability that I recently saw inside the virtual machine. For some background, the word topology comes from mathematics and geometry, where it refers to properties of an object that remains invariant even after some specific transformations, such as stretching, twisting, crumpling, and bending. In electronics and informatics instead, it is used to describe the interconnections and the relationships between the various components of a computer system. So now that I think about it, I have definitely been in the mood of wanting to stretch, twist, crumple, and bend a CPU, and let's see if after that it will keep showing that bug in my code. But anyway, when there is no virtualization, the physical topology of a system describes how many CPUs, caches, memory, and I/O controllers we have there, and how they are organized in threads, cores, sockets, hierarchy of caches, NUMA nodes, and I/O buses and bridges. On a standard Linux system, there are multiple ways of analyzing the topology. For instance, just using less CPU will already reveal a lot of useful information. NumaCTL-hardware is another way to inspect how the CPUs and the memory are arranged in NUMA nodes. And last but not least, Linux offers a really convenient set of interfaces for checking which CPUs are part of which core and package, what other CPUs they share resources with, and a whole lot of other information like this ones. They are all available within the SysFS special file system, which means they can also be queried from programs and scripts. When, on the other hand, a graphical representation is preferable, a tool called LSTopo from the HWLock project can be used to produce diagrams like this one in the slide. This provides a very immediate and clear look of the system's components, their relationships, and their interconnections, which is, in fact, by definition, the system topology. Now, if you have ever tried using any of these tools inside a virtual machine, you know already that it is very much possible to do it. In fact, they work, and the output they produce has the same format and look of what we see on bare metal. But of course, when you are looking at what you are looking at is the virtual topology of the VM. It is the job of the hypervisor and of the other components of the virtualization stack to put together the necessary pieces, like CPU ID bits and virtual ACPI tables, in such a way that when the operating system running inside a VM reads them, it will configure itself like if it were running on a piece of hardware that had the topology that the user requested. Let's just look quickly at some examples and at how they can be configured. Here, for instance, we see how to put together a virtual topology where all the 8 vCPUs are seen as separate sockets and at how the results look from inside the VM. This is, by the way, the topology that Kimu builds by default. This is instead how we can make the vCPUs look like they are arranged in cores and threads, or even in virtual NUMA nodes. Note that recent enough versions of Kimu and libvirt allows us to specify even the distance between the virtual NUMA nodes, exactly like on real hardware. In general, querying the details about the physical system topology and then take them into account when making decisions, mainly at the OS kernel level, is a good thing. The scheduler in the kernel is probably the most obvious example. In fact, in the scheduler, if the scheduler knows about symmetric multithreading, it can avoid scheduling tasks on two threads if there is a full core available, which improves performance. Or it can try to run a task on the NUMA node where the memory that it uses the most resides, and this improves scalability. And in fact, these ones and other features are all there inside the Linux kernel scheduler. But what about virtual topology? I mean, can the scheduler running inside a VM that has a virtual topology which includes SMT behave the same as it would on bare metal and then assume to have done equally as good at improving the performance of the workload running inside the VM? Well, if the VM has an SMT virtual topology, the scheduler will behave like on bare metal, that is for sure. And it will probably run the task T2 from the example in this slide on either vCPU, V2 or V3. But is this good or is it bad? Or maybe we just can't tell with only this information? Yes, the correct answer is in fact that you can't tell. In order to know whether it will be good or bad to run the task T2 on any of the vCPUs, say V2, we would need to know things like on which physical CPUs the vCPUs V1 and V2 actually run, and maybe also what other host tasks run on the system's physical CPUs, besides the vCPUs of the VM, I mean. So, I mean, is there even any point in having virtual topology? Because if it's like that, the scheduler inside the VM will never know all these things. So how is this all supposed to work? Well, one idea is to configure the system at the host level so that the scheduler inside the VM does not need to have all this information. In fact, if each particular vCPU of each VM only and always ran on a specific pCPU on the host, then all the uncertainty about virtual to physical CPUs relationship and mappings just goes away. Therefore, if we know that, for example, vCPUs 0 and 1 of VM1 will always run on pCPUs 0 and 1 of the host, and that P0 and P1 are two threads of a core, then it sure makes sense to have the scheduler in VM1 working in the same way as if V0 and V1 were threads of the same physical core. And yes, if we provide it with this information by means of defining a virtual topology for VM1 with SMT, decisions made according to such a topology will likely have a positive effect on performance and scalability inside VM1 itself. Now, let's look again at the host a little bit better. So if we also configure the system in such a way that the vCPUs of each of our VMs run in this joint subset of physical CPUs, then we are doing what is called dedicated resource partitioning for the VMs. What about host tasks that are not vCPUs? Well, ideally, you would isolate your vCPUs from any interference, including the one coming from host tasks. However, if the system is only devoted to running virtual machines, the interference from regular host tasks would hopefully be small, or maybe it is enough to shield the vCPUs from just a few of them. And in that case, such configuration can still be addressed to as dedicated resource partitioning. So this is how, in my experience at least, the topic of whether or not a VM should have a virtual topology is typically dealt with. Basically, we use and we recommend giving a VM a virtual topology if and only if we have dedicated resource partitioning. And yeah, by the way, how dedicated resource partitioning is implemented is by means of vCPU pinning and also memory pinning. They both can be configured from libvirt as shown, for example, in this slide. In case you want to implement vCPU pinning, but in such a way that the virtual topology of the VM will match the physical topology of the host, this might be slightly tricky at times. Doable, of course, but I suggest having some pills against headache handy when you try to do that. In fact, Kimu picks up the vCPUs in order and puts them in place inside the virtual topology. On the other end, though, the physical CPU ID's numbering not only is interesting, But it is also different between a system and another one. As an example, you can see here the physical CPU's numbering scheme in an AMD EPYC server, and on the right, what we had to do to achieve a properly matching virtual topology in a VM running on it. Okay, yes, as already said, this is the KIMU and libvirt default virtual topology for your VMs if you don't define one yourself. As you can see, it is a flat one with no dependencies and no sharing of computational resources or caches. And well, after all, something has to be used as default, I guess, and it is a good idea making it flat, as we do not know in advance the characteristic of the hardware where one would want to run the VM, whether or not there will be resource partitioning, and so on and so forth. Maybe one thing to note is that a configuration like this, where all CPUs are full sockets, is not really so common in hardware, but we will get to this later in the presentation. Okay, enough introduction. Didn't I say that I wanted to talk about this try to wake up function? Well, let's do it. It is, surprise, surprise, one of the functions that in the Linux kernel is responsible for doing the work of waking up a task. When such an event happens, it happens on a CPU, which we will call the wake up CPU. The woken task needs to go in a scheduler's run queue. More precisely, as soon as the CPU where the task needs to run is identified, and we will call it the target CPU, the woken task needs to be put in its run queue. Then the target CPU must be somehow notified that there is a new task for it, and if the CPU was idle, probably the task will just run immediately, as shown in this example here. If, on the other hand, the target CPU was not idle, then the newly woken task may or may not run immediately, depending on whether or not it will preempt the other task running there, as shown in this other example. Now, in order to highlight the impact of the topology in the task wake up path, let's ask the help of ftrace and tracemd. In fact, if we trace the wake up path, we first of all find the event about a task T1 which is waking up. We also see that the event itself happened on CPU P0 and that the task T1 wants to run on CPU P2. Now, do you see that function called CPU's share cache? Yes, here it is where our Bilhoff topology comes into play. Basically, we check whether the wake up CPU and the target CPU share the LLC, which is typically the L3 cache. And if they do, like in this case, then P0 takes the spin lock of P2's run queue and puts T1 directly inside it. This is reasonable as probably both the run queue and the spin lock of P2's run queue will be present in the shared L3 cache already. And even if they are not there, they do belong there, in the sense that bringing them in most likely does not mean fetching them from another L3 cache and having to deal with coherence and all that is related to that. It is also still P0, so the wake up CPU, that can check whether either a preemption is necessary or P2 needs to be woken up from an idle state. For instance, in this case, P2 was idle, and since it is monitoring the rescheduling flag with literally the monitor instruction, waking it up from idle only requires for P0 to set that flag, and it does not even take an IPI. Let's now look at what happens if there is not any shared L3 cache between wake up and target CPU. Well, T1 still wakes up on P0 and it now wants to go to P3. Accessing directly P0, from P0, the run queue of P3 is out of question. That would, in fact, mean bringing in P0's L3 cache data from another L3 cache and have the CPU have to deal with cache coherency and stuff like that, which works, of course, but is not as efficient and as convenient as before. Therefore, we basically stash T1 in a wake-up list. Then P3 wakes up and goes picking up T1 from the wake-up list itself and start running it. So why are we talking about all this? Well, I just think that this is a rather nice example of how the system topology might actually have effects which goes beyond just the ones that one usually and easily can attribute to it. Okay, this was all about bare metal, but we are at KVM Forum. KVM Forum is about virtualization. Shall we look at the virtualization case? So, as we have seen, it is all about that function called the CPU's shared cache. Do then the virtual CPUs of our VMs share an L3 cache? Well, a few years ago, the answer would have been an outright no. That is because back then, KIMU was not including any L3 cache in the description of the virtual topology. Now it does, and interestingly enough, the reason why it was added was exactly that behavior of try to wake up that I just showed. But the fact that we have an L3 cache in there does not mean that it is shared between any particular pair of vCPUs. That depends on the virtual topology. For instance, with the default virtual topology, no virtual CPU shares any cache with any other. On the other hand, with a different virtual topology that one may define, like one where all the vCPUs are defined as cores of the same socket, then yes, they do. So let's redo what we have done on bare metal, which is trace the wake up of a task, but this time inside a VM. And let's do it for a VM with the default topology. That basically means that no matter which one is the wake up CPU and which other is the target vCPU, then they will just never share an L3 cache. So the trace is in fact similar to the bare metal one when there was no L3 cache shared, and in fact we see the wake list there. The inter vCPU notification mechanism is different though, as in this case we do need an IPI. Note that even in the case when P2, so the target CPU, is busy, things are pretty much the same. The only exception that then T1 may or may not run immediately there, that depends on the results of check preempt core, which needs to be called, needs to happen on P2. If we switch to another virtual topology, so that now wake up vCPU and target vCPU share a virtual L3 cache, we see that as it was happening on bare metal already, the wake up vCPU is now putting the task directly in the run queue of the target vCPU. Pretty much everything is the same, even if the target vCPU is currently busy. Note, however, that it is the wake up vCPU that does the preemption check. It is important when we check what happens if that preemption check tells us that the newly woken task, T1, should not preempt T2 that is currently running on the target vCPU. In fact, in that case, thanks to the fact that we were able to do the check from the wake up vCPU, and since we already have put the proper the T1 in the proper run queue, there is nothing else that we need to do. So basically, with respect to the case where the default virtual topology was used, we are saving sending an IPI to the target vCPU, which is always a good thing, especially considering that it would have been a kind of a useless IPI, so causing us a VM exit and disturbing the target vCPU for nothing, as no rescheduling is really in order. So can we please have always the virtual topology with a shared L3 cache, one would think. Well, remember that the kernel in the VM was behaving like we saw in the traces because we told it that the involved virtual CPUs were sharing a virtual L3 cache. But where does the actual data that was accessed resides? For example, when the wakeup vCPU put the task directly inside the target vCPU rank queue, where was that rank queue located in the real system? Inside which L3 cache? Was it really inside the L3 cache of the physical CPUs where both the wakeup and target vCPU were running? Well, yes, for example, in this example that is shown in this slide. Yes, also in this other example. So even if we do not have a one-to-one pinning, both target and wakeup CPU share an L3 cache. In this other example, however, no, they may not. So the whole point that I am trying to make is this one. We are used to consider providing a VM with a virtual topology only when we are able to do dedicated resource partitioning with a one-to-one pinning of vCPUs to physical CPUs. However, what if, for example, we manage to guarantee for each of our VMs, even if the CPU moves around vCPUs, that they always stay inside an LLC domain, which most typically is a NUMA node? Would they benefit in such a situation from having a virtual topology defined different than the default one? And if yes, which one? So these are all open questions, and one would need some experimental analysis and some benchmarking in order to try to answer to them. Actually, I have done some benchmarks. So I have used a Xeon Platinum platform for that with 96 CPUs arranged in 2 nodes, 24 cores and 2 threads. The benchmarks were running at the same time inside 1 and then 4 and then 12 and then 18 VMs. The VMs had 12 vCPUs each, meaning that with 12 VMs we were having as many vCPUs as the host has vCPUs, while with 18 VMs we were in overload. And I used MMTest as a benchmarking suite, and this is some really big shameless self-advertising. It is growing some really nice virtualization benchmarking capabilities. So I have run and am still running several benchmarks. These ones are just the 3 ones that I will be talking about in this presentation. So I used Hackbench with a varying number of thread groups. I used the pipe benchmark from Perf, where 2 tasks are exchanging messages in a tight loop using a pipe. And I used Sketchbench with a varying number of clients. We want to check the performance with different configurations in terms of how the resource partitioning is implemented. Basically, we want to check the effectiveness of various ways of trying to keep each VM running on a specific subset of physical CPUs, so the ones that share an L3 cache, so that we can hopefully benefit from the more cache sharing friendly virtual topologies. So far, I have done that at the granularity of NUMA nodes, and so I have run the benchmarks with the default pinning configuration, which is no pinning at all. Then I have enabled NUMAD, which in theory should work as a mean of at least keeping each VM on one NUMA node. Then I have added some pinning, but only pinning the VMs to NUMA nodes. So all the vCPUs of each VM were pinned to all the vCPUs of a specific NUMA node. And then I have also looked at the dedicated resource partitioning with one-to-one pinning case, even just for reference. As far as VM topologies go, of course, I benchmarked the default one, which we can see here for a VM with 8 vCPUs. Then I checked an all cores topology so that all the vCPUs do share an L3 cache, but not much else. And I finally also looked at a topology with both cores and threads. Theoretically speaking, if we really manage to reliably keep a VM running on a NUMA node, these two topologies here, which define a shared L3 cache, should be able to take advantage of that. Also, in the one-to-one pinning case, this last topology here is the one that let us achieve the perfect one-to-one mapping between physical and virtual topologies. Now, to the results for Hackbench. This is a comparison of all the possible combinations of all the tested configurations and topologies when running only one VM on the host. On the x-axis, there is the number of threads group launched in parallel by Hackbench. On the y-axis, the average wake-up latency. It seems that the red line with full dots is almost always the best, and it corresponds to per NUMA node pinning with 8 cores in one socket virtual topology. There are also other combinations of pinning and topology that are able to achieve good performance, but it appears quite evident that the default topology with its 8 sockets is pretty much always the worst performing one. When moving to 12 VMs, which means that we are saturating the CPU capacity of the host, things do not change much. Now it is the one-to-one pinning configurations that provide the best results, but only if also a topology with a shared L3 cache among the vCPUs is used. The per node results follow closely and show the same pattern and trends. In fact, the line that corresponds to one-to-one and per node pinning, but with the default topology, are the yellow one with empty squares and the blue one with X's, and they are not looking good. We can also look at the per node configuration in some more details, still for the 12 VMs case. From this view, it is quite easy to see that among the three tested topologies, the one with 8 cores and the one with 4 cores and 2 threads are pretty much always largely better than the default one. Changing angle one more time, we see the confirmation that if we fix the topology to one socket and 8 cores, the one-to-one pinning configuration is the best for this benchmark, but the significantly less stringent per-node pinning configuration is really, really close. It is also interesting to note that the NUMA-D configuration is instead rather far behind. In fact, it could have been expected that NUMA-D would be able to put in place a de facto per node pinning configuration and then achieve similarly good results, but this is not happening, and this, I guess, probably deserves further investigation. Finally, if we check what happens when we overload the host with 18 VMs, which means a total of 144 virtual CPUs over 96 physical CPUs, the trend is confirmed. The default topology is the worst for this benchmark, especially at higher thread groups count. Sketbench, however, shows us a slightly different picture. In fact, if we look straight at the behavior of the per node pinning configuration this time, with the various topologies, we see that in this case the default topology is actually the one performing the best, both with a moderate load of 4 VMs and at full capacity with 12 VMs. And this is also true in case we check the one-to-one pinning configuration. Interestingly, though, pinning to the vCPUs, one-to-one to the PCPUs, and also making the VM topology exactly match the host one, is not only performing worse than, for example, the default topology, it is actually performing the worst of all configurations. And this is a little bit strange, and I think this also deserves being investigated a little bit further. Last but not least, the perf-pipe results. Here, the performance seems to be entirely dominated by topology, actually, as we can see from how the data points show up grouped in clusters. In fact, both with 1 and 4 VMs, the 8-core topology leaves basically everyone else behind, whatever the pinning strategy is. Interestingly enough, the default topology is not the worst performing one these times, as the 4-cores and two threads actually is. And this is exactly the same. The trend is confirmed here for the 12 VC VMs, and even when we are in overload. Okay, I hope you did not have enough of graphs at this point, because I have another one. I have the one that I promised at the beginning of the talk I wanted to also talk about. So this is the stream benchmark run inside a VM that was tuned to have the same performance as the host. And as you can see from the graph, it does that very well for 3 out of 4 operations of the benchmark. For the copy operation, we apparently have tuned the VM too well, because it goes sensibly faster than the host itself. So this took us, especially a former colleague of mine, some serious head scratching back then, but after a while we found out this. So basically, while performing copy inside the VM, non-temporal prefetch instructions were used. On the other hand, the optimization was not being taken advantage of when running on bare metal. Our configuration for stream was a little bit special, I have to admit. We were using some large array in memory, and this is not special for stream, but also quite a lot of threads, and this is. Also, this behavior was observed on a system running glibc version 2.2. And in such a version of the library, there is a threshold that is computed in order to decide whether or not to use non-temporal prefetches and store in the memcopy implementation. And the way the threshold is computed takes into account the size of the L3 cache available in the system. Therefore, what was happening was that on bare metal, the size of the memcopies was just below the threshold, and so the prefetch NTA instructions were not used. In the VM, it was above, but the size of the main copy was the same. It was the threshold that, in the VM, it was smaller. In fact, the physical CPU had 64 megabytes of L3 cache in total. On the other hand, in the VM, we were using the Kimu default emulated cache, which is reported to the VM as being 16 megabytes. And having so many virtual CPUs with a so small L3 cache resulted in an unrealistically low threshold in the VM, which allowed the VM to use the optimization even if it should not be used. So the solution to an issue like this is to make sure that the VM is provided with a meaningful cache topology in terms of also of cache sizes. In this case, it was easy enough fixing our situation by just using the cache pass-through mode from libvirt and Kimu. And as I said, the specific heuristics that computes the threshold are not even there any longer in more recent versions of glibc. However, the issue is general, meaning that having only the 16 megabytes L3 cache hash provided by emulates or full cache pass-through available in Kimu means that we can, for example, end up creating a VM with just a few CPUs and a giant cache, which is not something that really exists in actual hardware. And some other threshold, either in glibc or somewhere else, which is instead designed with what exists in actual hardware in mind, may cause us other problems. Therefore, I now am wondering whether this might mean that we need to put in place mechanisms for describing a virtual cache hierarchy with sizes and all its other details and make it part of the virtual topology that we allow a VM to have and see. And here we are to the last bit, and it is indeed appropriate to call it like this, I guess. So I have recently saw L1TF being reported as vulnerable inside a big VM, a VM with around 2.7 terabytes of RAM. And I am talking about inside the VM, so not the crazily scary virtualization variant of L1TF. This is the 1TF that is trivially mitigated by PCIe inversion. So how come the VM is vulnerable? Well, the answer lies in checking a less CPU inside the VM and the last entry of the AE820 map still inside the VM and shown here in this slide. And again, it is somewhat related to topology, I would say. In fact, while the host has 46 bits available for virtual addresses, Kimu, while constructed the VM, told it that it can only use the 42 of them, which is fine because the address of the last portion of usable RAM is representable on 42 bits. But as soon as you take one out for implementing PTE inversion, that then is no longer the case. And that's the kernel complaint and the warning about a potentially insecure system. So this would be yet another of those cases where we need a richer and more flexible way of expressing the virtual topology. To be fair, Kimu can already do that. It is only libvirt support that is currently missing, forcing people to put in place hacks like this one in these slides. But patches for libvirt are in the works. If I had to draw some early conclusions from this ongoing activity of mine about investigating virtual topologies, I would say that physical topology has more effects on the behavior and on the performance of a computer system that one may think if looking just naively at it. And in virtualization, when it comes to virtual topology, this is actually even more true. Also, it is worth, at least according to me, continuing enhancing KVM, Kimu, and libvirt in such a way that they will become able to more accurately describe and represent all the aspects of the physical topology and have them reflected in the virtual topology. It is sure more code maintained and maybe, I don't know, more parameters to Kimu, which definitely is not in need of such a thing. But at the end of the day, software running inside the virtual machine, both at the kernel or at the user level, may either depend or radically change its behavior if we miss this or that. And while more benchmarks are definitely necessary in order to be conclusive, it is probably the case that virtual topology is not really only relevant when we are able to provide a VM with dedicated access to the host resources. Instead, when configuring a system, especially if some resource partitioning is being applied, but even if not in an exclusive way, we should probably think at whether this allows us to define a virtual topology for the VMs different than the default one, and check whether that let us maybe reach better performance. And And this concludes my talk. Here in this slide you can find some information about me and my contacts in case you want to reach out. And now, thanks again for attending, and I will be happy to take any questions.